Well, the grace of God keeps delivering knockout blows to me, and what more can you ask for, right? And I just, my prayers are that all of you experience these knockout blows every day, these positive, super positive knockout blows. I had one yesterday. It was just so amazing. I'm just, you know, still knocked out by it a little bit, which is fine. And then this morning, another knockout blow came, which is great. This is what we live for. What else do we live for in this world except to be knocked out from this world, knocked out from death, actually? What we're aiming for is the death of death. Yes, we are, most certainly. And are there many deaths or just one? Just one. Many labels to it. We have, you know, trillions of labels that we affix to death. But it's just one death, which is an excuse we're making to try and cover up our arrogance. So we don't need to get free of many different types of death. Death is death, right? Death is death. Impermanence is impermanence. Death is death. Doesn't matter whether a tree dying, insect dying, you know, whatever it is, right? It's still death, right? So all we have to do is get free of the one death. The death of death. What is the death of death? Realizing what we are. Can never die. Started out the day in the right way. I got this papaya yesterday. Very, very nice, and I scooped it into the Nutribullet container, and then I put Odwalla chocolate protein drink in there, and then 100% whey protein powder, a couple of scoops. Blended that up. And it's all thick and rich and chocolatey. It's like a chocolate milkshake, except it's super good for you. How about that? There's the death of death right there, right? I love chocolate milkshakes. I mean, who doesn't? Who doesn't like chocolate? But I can't have them. So here we have something that tastes, I would say it tastes even better. It is absolutely, I mean, this is a new drink I've guessed, sort of discovered, invented, you might say. And I'm telling you, something about using the papaya, it gives a real rich, velvety texture to it. But without the taste coming into the, you know, it just is a subtle thing. You can hardly taste it, but good Lord, that is really, 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 really good. And I get all the health benefits of that, right? And still have the taste of a chocolate milkshake. The death of death. We get all the benefits of ornamentation and still have all the bliss. What do we think is dying? Bliss. We think is dying. When death dies, we experience bliss, which is complete right now. Total presence right now. Nothing is being disintegrated. Nothing is being added. Nothing is being subtracted. It's peaceful, still, perfectly present, 100%. So I did a meditation. I was willing. Let me tell you what happened, and you can get some inspiration from this. I was given this gift yesterday by someone that had, I've had conversations with about Tibet, and suddenly he said he's going to give me some DVDs. He's a traveler, an adventurer, a trekker, and he said one day I asked him, hey, have you ever been, you know, ever seen Mount Kailash or gone around? And he said, oh, absolutely, actually, in fact, I have, and I have a DVD I'm working on, and I'll give a copy of it to you when I'm done of my trip around Mount Kailash. And I said, what? He said, yeah. I said, oh my gosh. So yesterday, he suddenly yells across the parking lot, hey, I've got it for you. And I was really feeling really down at that time. And it just completely shifted. It gave me a total power shift. I was feeling very depressed. And this changed everything. He says, here, I got it for you. So I went home and I watched it. Oh my gosh. First of all, he did a super genius job in the editing and the production of it. I mean, it just it's it it could be on television, the documentary. The quality is so good. And secondly, the scenery and the ambience and just the cinematography that he did was just fabulous. He must have, I mean, even though he probably had a super great camera, it certainly looks like it. You know, very steady, everything's beautiful and steady. But the work he put into it and the shots he took, every way he did it was just like incredibly good. Just great. Super, super great. Super positive job. And then the scenery of going into Tibet and in northern India, then going across the border to Tibet and Lake Manrasovar, so whatever you call it, Manrasovar, it's a long name, Tibetan name, that beautiful lake, and there's Mount Kailash, and going around it, trekking around it, everything, the scenery, the monasteries, the yaks, the animals, the people, just, it was just astonishing job. I know how difficult it is, so I appreciate the difficulty, the degree of difficulty, and the dedication that he put into it. And I was just given this in the morning. Hey, here he, and I, and so seeing all this, it just, wow. But what it did was it sort of knocked out any desire for me to go to Mount Kailash or to go to Tibet. I've always heard of this, you know, that sacred lake up there, Manrasovar, something like that, and Mount Kailash there, and it's like the greatest pilgrimage site in the world for the Hindus and for the Tibetans and for the Eastern religion people. It's like the place, the sacred mountain. And so this has always been this, I always wonder, what's it really like? I was really ignorant of it. Well, now I've seen it up close in the most vivid way. This was just given to me. You talk about a grace at work here. The Dharma King's at work here. And I have no desire to go to Tibet or Mount Kailash or anything. You know, it's just like, okay. This is what it's like. It's what it is. It's the world. Hello, it's the world. It's the realm of death. And this whole, I can tell you that this world, starting with bodies, these bodies, nature, animals, minerals, dirt, rocks, trees, sky, the world, and the universe, the entire universe, the world, all of this is a mental projection of spirit as an excuse. It's simply an excuse. It's trying to excuse some of its arrogance. It's saying, yeah, God, I'm really arrogant, but this part of my arrogance isn't arrogant. Meaning, yeah, God, reality is almost real. Most of reality is real, but some of it isn't. It's all that it is. It's just merely an excuse. And so when you see it that way, you're looking at the scenery and everything, and you say, wow, yeah, but. And I just noticed, hey, wait a minute, you know, everything's the same as here, as everywhere else here. It's just this excuse. Everything's crumbling into dust. Everything's dying. And so you see the screen upon all this projection of ornamentation, but you see the screen is constantly crumbling. It's portraying impermanence, death, meaning that there's some aspect of reality that's somehow fixed, you see. How could anything die unless there's something fixed first? Let's ask ourselves this question. This is one of those questions that really, you know, it's like a roto drill question. You know, a jackhammer that just goes right in. And how can anything die if nothing's fixed in the first place? So this, what is this world? A picture of apparent fixation in scooping up dust and making more fixation and scooping up, making more fixation so it can crumble again. But in reality, nothing's fixed. It's all completely indeterminate. There's nothing determinate at all in reality. In other words, we're perfectly free. One moment, one instant, it's never bound to any other instant at all, which means it's all perfectly fresh. untouched and fresh. This is reality. And so there's no determinate nature to reality whatsoever, none. Which this means we're completely free to experience anything we want to at any instant. Which means we could be completely creative, totally creative, right? Now this is beyond our imagination that we have right now in terms of how we look at it conceptually and image-wise. Sure, because there's no fixation. So what is this planet? Nothing but fixation, a picture of fixation. It's an illusion of fixation, actually. But a very clever, profound illusion, you might say. So I'm looking at all this scenery, and I see just all the boulders, and then the rocks, and the rivers, and the stones, and the pebbles, and the dust. And it's just, everything is just wearing down. It's very raw there. It's very very dry and raw, and just the scenery, just, you know, it's very vivid, and I didn't get lost in the beauty and vividness of it. I said, hey, wait a minute, you know, this is just the same as any place in the world, actually. There's no real difference at all in Tibet compared to anywhere else in the world, or Mongolia. I've seen documentaries of across Mongolia riding motorcycles. I've seen, you know, places, Gobi Desert and all the, you know, Sahara, all these different places in the world I've seen on documentaries, and I say, hey, it's the same as anywhere else. But now Lake Mount Kailash was really something to see that and realize it's just the same as everywhere else. My gosh, there's no sacred place in the world. Not at all. Is some form of impermanence sacred? Is some illusion of impermanence, death, sacred? How could that be? How could that be? Excusing our arrogance? So it knocked out something out of me, and then I suddenly felt like, you know what, I'm finished with the world. There's nothing, I can turn my attention entirely off of this world. This is how I feel. Completely block out the world. I have no more interest in this world. And I don't feel scared, jittery about it. I just say, yeah, I'm ready to renounce the world. You call it renouncing the world. Detachment from the world. So I meditated on that this morning, and I didn't feel any trepidation or concerns or doubts or anything. It was just like, yeah, I'm ready for eternal life, which is no fixation at all. That's real life. Any fixation is an illusion. It's a dream of death. It's a dream of death. It's all it is. This dream of death, which we call the universe, the world, bodies, is simply an excuse that we're using to say to God, you know, almost all of reality is true, but not all of it. I'm mostly arrogant, but not entirely. You know, all my arrogance is mostly arrogant, but not all of the arrogance is arrogant. Because this world here is responsible for how I feel and think. And so I'm not to blame. I'm not accountable. I cannot change it. You know, I have to work within the fabric of the universe to bring about some sort of change. But I cannot drop my arrogance because it's not all coming from me. Well, this is an excuse to hold on to arrogance. It's all it is an excuse to hold on to arrogance, is it not? To say that some of our arrogance is out of our control and we have to work within the time, space, process, and form to make all these changes and alterations, meaning we can't do it right now. That if we're saying we can't do it right now, that means it's out of our control, because God created us in the now, in the moment, absolutely free, unfixated. So dropping arrogance is always 100% in now, in the now. We can do it all right now. There's nothing we have to wait on through time, space, process, and form to admit that all our arrogance is coming from us. If it's coming from us, we can drop it instantly. But if some of it's not coming from us, which is what we're saying, then, oh no, wait a minute, God, I'm really working on it, you know, I'm working on it. That's arrogance, to say I'm working on fixing this part of my arrogance, which is out of my control. That's saying, hey, God, some of arrogance is also out of your control. I mean, you created me, but this arrogance is not coming from me, so we have to wait. You know, I can't be saved yet, God. I can't drop my arrogance yet. I can't drop my arrogance yet, because some of it's not coming from me. So if I say I can't drop my arrogance yet, what does that mean? I continue to be arrogant. So it's a delaying device, isn't it? It's a delaying device. It's an excuse and a delaying device, the whole universe is. It's a mental projection, this universe, of a dreamlike delusion. So this is some of a knockout explanation here, isn't it? Got the roto hammer out. It's amazing, the time is creeping up, the situations are creeping up on us as we keep waiting, but now we're seeing what waiting is all about, is it not? Saying that some arrogance, we have to wait and work and try to fix it. In other words, it wasn't a decision that we made, a desire, it's some sort of process. And God says, what do you mean? There's no such thing as process. Everything's completely indeterminate. It has to be your arrogance. So just in the looking at this, you know, it smooths it out. We relax more and more about it, which is the whole key. Familiarity is the key to success. It's the what is it, the 16th? I think, doesn't the Republican National Convention in the United States start on the 18th? The 18th through the 21st, 18th, 19th, 20th, 21st. So Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. I believe so. And I think then the 21st, Thursday, then Friday's the 22nd, Saturday, 23rd, Sunday, the 24th. And then I think the Republican starts on the 25th, 6th, 7th, and 8th. So the 24th, I believe, it would land on a Sunday, right? Yeah. So, I mean, I think, you know, it's like just about a week away. Is it not? The 24th is about a week away. Holy cow. So we're virtually upon it now. And what are we upon? Well, first of all, we're doing very well here, and so steady as she goes here. So we do have to steady our nerves, but we do that through these kind of really in-depth considerations and just looking together and understanding, just looking at this and say, hey, wait a minute, that's right. I mean, we think that something has to happen for us to drop arrogance. We can't drop arrogance without something happening. That would mean our arrogance is determinate, which means we're determinate. It would mean our arrogance is fixated, which means we're fixated. And God did not create fixation. Again, in order for something to die, there has to be fixation first. And so the answer to the death of death is to realize that there's nothing fixated. But then death says, well, there's no life. What death is really saying, then, well, nothing can die because there's no fixation. So keep in mind that we call this, quote-unquote, life that we're living here in the world. It's not. It's death. It's death, because in order for there to be death, there has to be fixation. So we're believing in fixation in order to believe in death. This is very true. As Jesus says, it's all fear-based. All of this is fear-based. So there's no value to this world whatsoever. It tells you absolutely nothing about what you are. Why? Because it's a dream of fixation, and what we are is no fixation. So how can a definition tell us anything about what has no definition? So now, it's very important to take this in, neither emotionally nor intellectually. The whole yin-yang male-female thing, what's the difference between male fixation and female fixation? Is it not both 100% a belief in death? Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Who cares what labels we affix to the belief in death? Who cares what labels we affix to the belief in fixation? We have tree fixation, male fixation, female fixation, old fixation, young fixation, concrete fixation. This is, those are just labels to our belief in fixation. It's, the belief is just the same. It's just one belief that we're not, you know, free. That we're determinate. That's all it is. So we have this yin yang thing, belief that, you know, there's different reactions we have, and some is an emotional reaction, and others are the, you know, more intellectual. Some of us intellectualize it, some of it, you know, emotionalize it. But what we do here is we just wow it, which is neither emotional nor intellectual. Okay, so you want to know wow? It's neither emotional nor intellectual, and it's not a combination of them either. It's like we're walking along a path and there's these enormous set of jaws on the side of the path. There's massive spikes on hydraulics, and they're going like this, you know. We know we have to get past there. Well, it's like that rattlesnake on the side of the path I was walking. And I said, what do? I got to get past this. I just suddenly leapt. And I got past it. What did I feel? I felt, wow. I'm safe. Now, isn't safety something other than emotions or intellect? It's more profound, isn't it? It's more profound. So the wow is a response to true profundity. That we're seeing our safety from what? From death. From death, from suffering, from misery, from everything that has bothered us. We're seeing that, wow, I just, for just a tiny instant, I just glimpsed it. I just felt it. I just, wow. And it's bigger wow than looking at Mount Kailash or looking at the Grand Canyon or anything like that. What we're doing here is a way bigger wow than any looking at nature or any situation in the world. Because this is truly profound. Those others are just contrasty kind of thing. Oh, look at that deep gorge, very contrasty. But here, we're actually seeing our liberation from self-delusion. So it's part, you know, relief, exhilaration, relief, and you know, the safety. It's just sort of this overall, lump it all together into just this wow, like a huge bell has been rung, and we're just reverberating. How could perfect freedom have a gender? It doesn't have any gender. There's no fixation at all and inequality. It's that which experiences all qualities and yet has none of its own. In other words, freedom experiences all experiences because it is perfectly free, but it never is fixated in any experience It always remains free. My wrist suddenly went bad yesterday. My left wrist. Never had anything like that happen before. Suddenly I couldn't move it. It was so super painful. Out of nowhere. I was just trying to do everything fine, and then just like next thing you know, I couldn't move my wrist. I said, what the heck? And then it's a funny thing, I mentioned it to someone and they said, well, that's really odd because I had the exact same thing happen to me this morning on my right wrist. And it's like, you'd be surprised if you can't use your wrist. You can't really do much of anything. I can't put any, weight on my, I cannot put any weight on my hand. Yeah, wow. So, what's this about? Something about what's coming up, I would say. Someone else suddenly had chest pains, and there's stuff, people are having panic attacks. This is being reported to me. So obviously there's something coming up. People I know that are psychic, for instance, they suddenly were like just super, super low. I said, what's wrong? I don't know what's wrong. I just feel terrible. And then they find out, someone texts them. They say, oh my gosh, some terrible, blah, blah, blah happened in the world. So we're all aware, actually, of all this nonsense that's going on. And it can show up in symptoms. My right wrist is fine. Why'd the left suddenly go bad? Yeah. Ah. I'm getting a little range of motion, but... Ah, wow. Well, it'll just have to ease off. It means that something's coming up. We know. And again, the Holy Spirit told me insistently that the summer 2016, and it pinned it down for me, June 24th through July 24th, is the heat up period, so to speak. You want to be really, really properly focused by July 24th, for sure. Okay, so, we've got about a week left. And I've been super committed to working on this, as you know. So, I took the advice of the Holy Spirit very seriously. It's been extremely insistent that this is all important. Now, if maybe you've been taking it easy, okay, don't worry, because one insight settles it all. And you can focus on this truth. And I tell you, this is true. I've experienced it, already experienced this. It is one insight settles it all. Now, I saw for an instant how all regrets that I've ever had just turned into nothing but beauty. Right now, this instant. So it was just from one little insight that I had, settled it all, absolutely settled it all. So you might be struggling with regrets and thinking, how do I feel better? No, that's not the way. Don't struggle with concepts, thoughts, feelings, intellect, sex, don't struggle with that either, whatever it is. One insight settles it all. This is absolutely true. Have faith in that. No matter what happens, say, I'm just one insight away from everything being settled in my favor, completely. Everything settled in my favor. Just one little insight away, and this is absolutely true. Now, I've held on to this belief my entire life. And I said, no, I know it's true. Whereas the whole world is saying, no way. We got a massive amount of process we got to go through. It's going to take a long time. And I said, no. You can, there's just one little insight settles it all, and that little insight can happen right this instant. It's just a shift of will and perception, a willingness, a shift of willingness to look at it this way, and then poof, all settled instantly. So I've always held on to this belief. In spite of the world being just almost universally opposed to this perspective, this is why it's so difficult for any of us here to succeed, because we, you know, just everything is opposed to us, against us in terms of the, of this key insight. One insight settles it all. One insight settles it all. Only the Dharma kings will tell us this, actually. They're the only ones that really tell us this. And those who work for them will pass on this information and experience it for themselves, so gain conviction in it. Now, it was a momentary experience, but I saw it very clearly. One insight does indeed settle it all. So if you really just hold on to that, it's like a life raft, okay, in the ocean of madness here. And it's truly an ocean of madness. And the ocean is about to get very stormy. Very, very stormy. As we are seeing. Are we not seeing this? I said it's going to be the long, hot summer. It is going to heat up, and it is heating up. And that's going to rage through August and into September. And who knows? At that point, all bets may be off. You know, really, all bets are already off. Don't put any faith in the machinations of the world, okay? Forget about the world, because one insight settles it all for you. All involvement with the world, with this dream of death, all of it is resolved with just one simple little insight. Easy, simple insight. It completely resolves in your favor. Now we have to be patient. I had this experience. I saw it. I'm not having it right now. If I try to struggle and get it back, it's going to push it further away. Okay, so I just take it in stride and wow it. Don't ever struggle with, when you get knocked out, don't struggle with it. Just take it in stride and say, okay, great, love it, wow. Just wow it. And this, you just stay in stride and keep going, and you just remain patient. Now, will it come back? Well, whatever comes back will be even better in terms of clarity and profundity and stuff. So don't fixate on any experience. Just realize that, wow, I got to it. One insight does indeed settle it all. This is the heart of the Dharma, of the Gospel. It's called redemption. One insight absolutely settles every single misery, suffering, regret that you've ever had, whether in this lifetime or any other lifetime, or any that you ever could ever imagine having. It, one little insight settles all of that permanently. Gone. All in your favor. Completely resolved in your favor. Without any sense of regret or lack at all. It's all in your favor. Completely resolved in your favor. So this is the Dharma, the Gospel that I'm preaching here, and you're hearing. And this is precious, very, very precious, because this is a life raft. It's a lifeboat for you. It's a lifeboat. Okay, so what we're talking about is get in the lifeboat at this time. And this one little insight settles it all, is the lifeboat for you and for me. I'll be in that lifeboat too, okay? So we don't need to worry about thinking. No, just one little insight settles all thinking, all conceptualization, all confusion, all regrets, everything that bothers us. It's all settled, smoothed out, and settled in our perfectly in our favor. Completely smoothed out. No rough spots to it. One simple little insight, and that is it. Again, I have personally experienced this, so I'm telling you this is true. So get in get in that lifeboat as the Titanic is about to sink, actually. Or at least get close to that lifeboat. Get ready to jump in. But don't, it's better to get into the lifeboat right now. Okay, let me emphasize that. Get into this lifeboat. And this is more important than what kind of plans you're going to be making. I'm going to LA coming up in several weeks, you might say, for a memorial service. And I'd like to stay down there, but I don't have the funding to do so, you know, and I'd love to have a vacation, you know, and right now I don't have the funding. And I said, well, I'm upset, you know, I really need a vacation. And you know, boy, so I just say, but instead of getting upset about that, I have to make a really strong effort. Just say, no. Okay, it's more important to get in this lifeboat. So whatever, come what may, you have this very clear determination. I'm going to stick with this. That one insight settles it all. This is super. This is the best thing I can tell anyone, share with anyone. It's the precious, most precious gift possible. It's one insight settles it all. And we can practice that and say one insight has indeed settled it all. One insight did indeed settle it all. Well, this is rehearsing for us actually experiencing this, that I've already experienced it, and it's true, everything has been settled in my favor completely, meaning all death has vanished for me. All this impermanence, all this fixation, and then the impermanence of the fixation being seen as death, etc. All of this, all settled in my favor, that I was never fixated in the first place. Nothing has ever been fixated, no fixation whatsoever. And in the back of our mind, we keep saying, we know this is true, and the world's telling us, no, it's not true. And so you have all these regrets where we think, well, maybe the world is true. You know, maybe I'm wrong. But then one little insight you see, no, I'm right. I was right all along. There's no fixation. Completely settled in our favor, in the favor of truth, in the favor of Spirit, and of God, and the Holy Spirit. All settled in our favor completely. This is not a pipe dream at all. I've experienced it. It's easy. Again, the insight's very easy, very simple. But don't struggle to say, well, what is it, what is it, what is it? No. Rather, prepare for the wow of this. And when we're ready to have the wow of this, the insight will just be there. Okay, this is the right way to go about it. Never struggle and try to grasp the key insight. Okay, this doesn't work. It will just suddenly bloom for you when you're ready to handle the wow of it. If you're not ready to handle the wow of it, it won't bloom. And so we're struggling, trying to make this flower bloom. You know, we can't watering it, fertilizing it, nothing. It won't bloom. The way to water and fertilize it is to practice the wow. I'll just take it in stride. Now, we have a action guru, a very helpful guru, Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro, who models for us the right way to handle this sort of realization. Very self-effacing, poker-faced almost, and just calling no attention to himself, acting as if he doesn't know anything, yet at the same time being perfectly awake. Yeah. This is helpful for us right now in the world, because what you're going to see is a virulence in this world that we've never seen before. That insists that positivist action, we finally have the means to fix this this world, which is really, again, our make-believe pretense that there is a world that is causing some of the arrogance that God is, that we say is not all coming from me, God, it's coming from the world, and it's out of my control, but I'm fixing it, I'm working on making the world better so it's not so arrogant. This is what positivism is. Let's fix the world. Okay, that's the deepest delusion is let's fix this world. That's the yoga girl delusion. It's the deepest delusion. And of course, they have to dress it up as beautiful as possible. And so they're going to have all these yoga girls, and I'm seeing some. I allow myself to be aware of this. They're really styling. They've got this Barbie doll look going. Barbie doll, yoga girl look going. And they're going to be the cheerleaders. Got the pom-poms going. My girl is working on the pom-poms, yeah. And well, that's be true to your school and let your colors fly. Be true to your school. My girl is working on her pom-poms, yeah, and yep, she'll be yelling tonight. So be true to your school. In other words, be true to positivism, what they're saying. So just like, you know, at a football game, they got the cheerleaders out. What are the cheerleaders? Are the best-looking girls in the school, basically. Attractive, and they're saying, go, you know, fight, 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 you know, fight, fight, fight. Push them back, push them back, push them way back. Be true to positivism. Be true to your, fight, fight, fight for it. We can get, there's this terrible arrogance that's attacking reality, but God has sent us to defeat this arrogance, and we're going to make it positive, you know. This is the absolute heart of delusion, okay? It really is. From what we've explained here, now you can see, oh, wow, that is indeed what is taking place here. So you're going to have these uber cheerleaders all slicked up and dolled up and yoga'd out and saying, we are really, really going to get this super abundant positivity going here, and we, you know, yeah, the world's, and all this negativity that's in the world, that's just a foil for the positivity. Okay, this is really interesting to hear. So let me say this again. All the bad stuff, the bad guys, all of this negativity that's coming up, that's just an excuse for the positivity to jump up and say, hey guys, we really need to get positive about the world. Let's all work together and fix this world. Because this is really messing God up, you know. It's, and so, and by so the contrast, we'll get fooled by the contrast, because here are these, you know, mangy, you know, bad guys doing all this, you know, fearful stuff, or, you know, around the world, and oh, they're scaring the heck out. They're so hideous. They're scaring everybody. Oh God, the world's so negative. Oh, so terrible. And then up pops these slick, dolled up Barbie doll yoga girls. And saying, I am here, Joan of Arc pops up. I am here, there'll be millions of Joan of Arcs suddenly pop up. I am here to lead you guys to victory over this evil, over this negativity, over this badness. And we're going to make this world a super abundant, positive world. And then she's working the pom-poms, you know. They start working the pom-poms. Push them back, way back. Yeah, come on, guys, fight, 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 yeah. And this fires everybody up. That's what the cheerleaders do. They fire everybody up. The crowd, come on, crowd, start screaming at everybody, yeah. Come on, guys, fight, fight, fight. This is all set up. It's all completely set up like this. So we're super vulnerable to the contrast now. Do you see what we're getting here? We're super vulnerable to this contrast between the bad guys and the yoga girls. It's like a Hollywood movie, right? You get the, you know, central casting is cast these, like, these really bad guys, these criminal, terrible, evil guys, and it's cast them in such a way that, oh my gosh, they're truly hideous. Wow, they're awful. And then where's the hero or the heroine? And then here comes Joan of Arc in the movie. And everyone goes, oh, you're here to save us. You're here to inspire us. Yes, but you really must fight for the positivity. Oh, well, under your inspiration, we can't possibly lose. And it's like a movie. It's all scripted. It is scripted. It's entirely scripted. So what is it? What do movies do? They're designed to stir up your emotions, right? And hook you and bypass your reason. Emotions are a way to try and bypass our reason, as is intellectualizations. Intellectualizations. That's a tough one to say really fast, isn't it? Intellectualizations. Intellectualizing. Intellectualizing is a way to bypass our reason, and emotionalizing is a way to bypass our reason. It's part of our self-deception. So the movies are designed to stir up this contrast and emotionalism. Okay, well, the whole world is a movie. It's designed to stir up emotionalism. And then the yoga girls can jump right into that. And it's like, oh, I could breathe again. Oh, you're so beautiful. You're so wonderful. Just don't worry. You know, I can fix it. I know how to fix it. I will inspire you. There's a way. We can all be positive. We can all have a positive world. This is exactly the heart, the core of self-delusion. This is how it works. But again, the contrast is such that we get emotionally hooked, do we not? So we have to realize this, and we just say action gurus, inspirational gurus, theory gurus. We give you permission, use any and all means whatsoever to shield us from this emotional contrast. Because we're all somewhat vulnerable to it. I'm aware I'm vulnerable to it, sure. Absolutely. Who is not? Only the Dharma kings are not vulnerable to it. So we ask those who are not vulnerable to this, understand our vulnerability. We're admitting our vulnerability. We've repented. We understand we've made this really kooky script to deny our arrogance and therefore believe that God, reality is changeable. And we're trying to trick ourselves very severely right now. And so it's a super vulnerable time for us. So we're saying those who are not vulnerable to this, we rely upon you for your perfect assistance. And don't expect us to just, you know, say, oh, I'm not vulnerable. No, that's stupid. Of course we are. This is our own creativity at work. And working on our continuity, fear, and familiarity, and manipulating our continuity fear. So of course we're vulnerable. I could feel myself, you know, sliding at times, like, whoa, 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 you know. And you may be feeling it right now, too. It's like, whoa, you know. Oh, I need to find a yoga girl to inspire me, you know, towards positivity, that kind of thing. Or I need to be a yoga girl to inspire others to positivity, like that, right? And so catch yourself, say, oh, wow, I'm slipping into the root delusion right there. Positivity is the root delusion. Positivity is the root delusion. And we're like, oh my gosh, I'm not used to looking at it that way. Yeah, well, you'd be surprised how quickly you can get familiar with this when you're desperate enough, desperately determined. How are we doing here? Oh, good. I mean, it's taping, and so that's great. There's always problems with technologies, and I just struggle through them. But it's been rough. But what can you do? This, we got to struggle through the situation. So call upon the Dharma keys. I don't know what they can do. I'll tell you what happened. A very weird situation happened. Going to L.A., and then our close relative is in a hospital in Las Vegas, fighting for his life, and we don't know, you know, is he going to make it or not? It's real, you know, it's iffy. He, right now, he's rallying through all our prayers and his will, and but we were thinking we might have to rush over to Las Vegas. So I'm trying to make this reservation for L.A., and they wouldn't accept my credit card or debit card. The code isn't right, and it kept blocking it. I couldn't do it online. I said, God, this never happened before. It's really weird. So I had to call up the hotel, and what we get is some salesman for the hotel chain, and they make a reservation. Well, actually, someone makes a reservation for it, and it says, if you stay on the line, you're gonna get $100 off here and $50 off credit and blah blah blah. So just stay on the line, okay? And I said, oh, I don't know, what are they talking about? And just something told me, stay on the line. Okay. So I stayed on the line. I get this really slick guy, marketing, a great deal. And he says, you can stay in Las Vegas three nights and 4 days for like $200 at you know, some super great hotel. All you have to do is attend a seminar, a timeshare seminar, you know. And I was like, oh, okay, this kind of spiel, you know, I'm sure you've gotten that. Free cruise, all expenses paid, just listen to the seminar. And I said, oh, no, I'm going to hang up on this guy. Said, but some told me, he says, don't. And then he says, you go to either Orlando or Las Vegas. And I said, hey, wait a minute. I mean, we couldn't afford the hotels in Las Vegas anyway. They're expensive right now. It's crazy expensive. And we can stay for 3 nights and 4 days for $200. I'm sure they'll tack on resort fees and taxes and stuff to balloon it up. Of course. You know, everything these days is deception. But something told me, I've never agreed to anything like this in my life. And I agreed to it. And they charged us up front the price. And then they'll refund it if you attend. There's a refund. But they said they have to attend the next 45 days. And it's so I had to say, I got to pin you down on what day you can attend. And I said, well, I don't know, because our friend's in the hospital. And we don't know how long he's going to be there. He might be leaving. He might be staying. He might get worse. So I can't tell you exactly when we would have to go, because it might be an emergency thing. We want to see him when he's still alive and can talk. And so we might have to just, you know, go, but we don't know when. So I told him my situation. Honestly, I just said, look, I chose this because we might have to visit him, and I'm not sure. And he said, oh, okay, I understand what you're saying. Okay, I'm sorry to hear this situation. Okay, so, okay, I'll tell you what we're going to do. I'm going to talk to my supervisor, and he's going to give you an extension. And so you don't have to attend. You don't have to go to the hotel and whatever for, you know, an extra 90 days or something. So you're going to have 7 months or 9 months or whatever. He pushed it way back for me. So in other words, I said, well, yeah, I might go to Las Vegas, which is actually the last place in the world I ever want to go. It's like the most spiritually discouraging place on the planet, actually, because it's the realm of what? Superabundant positivity. So I'm saying, well, yeah, I might go to Vegas, but not now. You see what it was? I said, yeah, well, I'm not going to go now, but maybe later. So I said, well, I got money already taken out of my debit, which I don't even have. It's a shared debit account, but I don't have the money. So I sort of bought some time. I sort of bought something. But then I said, "What? This is crazy. What am I doing?" But then it came up to me, like, somehow this is helpful. Because we have some insurance in case we have to go there. We have a cheap way to stay there. And also, it's the last place in the world I want to go. So it puts tremendous pressure on me to say, hey, let me find something else, you know, better, so I don't go there. And it also enabled me to say to the world, to this guy, very nice man, I understand. I mean, he's trying to make a living, you know. I mean, it's a tough way to make a living. I understand it. He looked at my phone number and said, wow, there's a lot of lucky numbers in there. You know, people say that a lot. He says, you go to Vegas, you know, you better go to Vegas. He said, you could be a winner. And I said, hey, you know what? I'm already a winner. And he goes, ah, gotcha, man, that's great. And he really got a laugh out. It was like this aha moment for him. Somebody told him, I'm already a winner. And he responded to that, like, wow, that's really cool, someone to say that. So I felt like he's helping me out. There's just like, you know, somehow grace is helping me out in a weird way. Because I was just praying the whole day, praying, I don't want to go to Las Vegas. Because I was under a lot of pressure to go to Las Vegas on this trip down south. And I said, it's too much. I don't want to be there during this all-important time of the 28th and the 29th. The end of July is super important time. Jesus has given me an indication that he's going to give a blessing to the world on the 28th. We'll be at a funeral on the 28th. But we'll also be at a country club. So I don't know what to make of this. And you could see your life might be like up in the air right now, just like mine is, very up in the air. And then someone made reservations for us at this kind of old hotel that's not so great and it's cheap. And then I made reservations at this nicer place, but modern, not real nice place. And I know it's going to be everything's going to be smooth and really nice there, but it's expensive. Someone was going to pay for our hotel because we don't have the money. But they gave us a cheaper hotel. They said, I'm going to save money, so you got to go there. And finally I said no, because one of us didn't want to go. And I said, no. We'll have to find somebody to pay for the more expensive one, which is going to basically, you know, wipe me out and everyone else out of money completely. I'm not going to have anything left. But I said, no, I want to stay in this better place and not go to Las Vegas afterwards. We don't have the money. And so everything's up in the air. But the 28th is very important. So yeah, there's a funeral, but there's also a reception at a private swank country club, which might be very uplifting in some way. The 28th is a very important day. And then the 29th also. And so I'll be returning probably, just driving down to LA one day, the next day drive back. Which is, you know, that's a lot of driving back to back. So there's all these things, chess pieces are moving now, right? And then I want to go down to Coachella Valley, you know, instead of go back, but can't do that really. As far as I know, it's like, wow, everything's up in the air. Chess pieces are flying around the board right now. So in your life, you may find that stuff is just like suddenly up in the air. A lot of people are having panic attacks right now because this is what's happening. The chess pieces are really flying around the board as the ego makes its moves and the Dharma kings make their counter moves. And so you just have to trust it, okay? Because I'm telling you, everything is in flux now, just crazy. Like my plans, your future seems like up in the air, doesn't it? It can feel that way. And it's like, we're going to be flat broke, just from attending a funeral, flat broke. So that feels very much up in the air too. Like, well, what, you know, missing work. I mean, just don't have the money, pay the bills, everything is just up in the air. So just trust the Dharma kings. Let them work the chessboard here. Our job is to get ready to get in the lifeboats, which is one insight settles it all. One insight did indeed settle it all for me. Practice this. One insight did indeed settle it all for me. Now, we don't do any breathing exercises, any manipulation whatsoever of how we feel. But just remember to breathe. You will naturally, you know, don't just tighten up and forget to breathe. You know, just what insight does indeed settle it all. I virtually never have my attention on my breath, almost never. As soon as I do, my breathing gets interrupted. Like, how am I supposed to breathe? It's just so it's not a good idea. Unless you feel skilled in that way of watching your breath, if that's something, then that's fine. Because that's a technique that people have used. I never used that technique, but one insight did indeed settle it all for me. And just feel how fortunate you are. So it's rehearsing for this insight to arise. I guarantee you the insight is so simple and so easy, you can't believe that you haven't done it, had it before. You know, it's like, what? I could have always used that insight. My whole life that insight was there. It's so easy. And yet I've managed to overlook it my whole life. So it's so simple and easy, the very attempt to find it obscures it. Okay? The very attempt to find it obscures it. So we don't want to try and grasp it too much or look too much. Look, what we want to do is one insight did indeed settle it all for me. Wow. And then rehearse being poker faced about it, pretty much so, in terms of like Jamyang Kenzi Choki Lodro. Jamyang Lodro. Jamyang Lodro. It's like, so calm, nonchalant, self-effacing, no look at me, and yet he's abiding in absolute Rigpa, pure intrinsic spaciousness, pure, clear light, intrinsic spaciousness, clear light, emptiness, bliss. He's abiding in that all the time. So he helps us with our attitude. So we just rehearse, taking it stride. One insight did indeed settle it all. Now, of course, we're vastly relieved. So we're kind of allowing ourselves to feel some of this relief ahead of time. It's like, let's say you found out someone's going to buy you a brand new Ferrari. 216. And you're not sure what day they're delivering it, but they said sometimes this week they're going to deliver this Ferrari. So what do? You practice rehearsing, say, ah, there's a Ferrari in my driveway. The new Ferrari is here in my driveway. Wow. As if it's actually there. Okay. And so then you psychologically can do this. You feel the reactions that you would have. And then, so you start getting used to your reactions so they don't hit you all at once when the Ferrari is actually there. When the Ferrari is actually there, you feel like, oh, I've already experienced this many times and gone through the reactions. So you take it in stride. You see? You just take it in stride. And this is how we smooth out the continuity fear, it's called. We smooth it out. Whereas if you did no practice at all, and then there's that red Ferrari, your heart might start beating like this, and say, oh my God, I don't know what to do, I don't know what to say, I don't know how to react, this is overwhelming. And you get flustered, and it affects your whole psychology, and you think, oh, this Ferrari's too much for me, it's too much, I take it away, I don't really want it. You see, like that. So when this one insight does indeed settle all, when we get this insight, we want to have already smoothed out our reactions to it. So we don't say, oh, this is too much for me. I take it away, take it away. We don't want the cheerleaders, the yoga girls say, push it back, push it back, push it way back. We don't want that. We want to say, oh, yeah. Yeah, I was expecting this. I'm already have rehearsed it all. And so, now, of course, it's still going to be a big wow. Yeah, of course. But much less intense. We're not going for the intensity of a reaction. That's not the bliss. That's what positivity goes for, the intensity of reaction. No. Bliss is completely smoothed out and calm and peaceful. So we want to smooth out the reaction to our good fortune as much as possible. So then we can just abide in the bliss. Beautiful day again here. California is ridiculous. Nice breezes playing about in just a temperate, beautiful temperate, crystal clear day. It's just very pleasant with just a taste of warmth. But there's both a taste of warmth and a taste of coolness, and they're at play. One moment you feel the slight coolness, and the next moment you feel a slight warmth. It's like that. But what we're doing is we're rehearsing. One insight did indeed settle it all for me. Wow. So this is the wise way to practice. This is the way the wise are practicing now, right now. Because the wise know what's to come here in general terms. I don't have the details. I don't want to know the details, actually. That's very distracting. Because then you think, I got to do something about it. No, it's just there's going to be manic depressive mindset in the world. We're going to get caught trapped by positivity. The yoga girls will pop up like mushrooms. They're all rehearsing right now. They're working out like crazy. I'm out there with them, seeing them, and they are they're getting ready to be the Joan of Arcs. So many Joan of Arcs. Don't worry, guys. We know that positivity will triumph. And you're the means that God has given the world to triumph over the negativity. So we will not allow you to lose your nerve. No, we will not. We will inspire you. This is what the yoga girls have done throughout history. And this has gone on, you know, since the beginning of our imagining this ridiculousness, one way or the other. But right in human, in far as human history goes, this is always what's going on. Same old, same old, same old. It's just the guise of the yoga girls, Joan of Arc, her get up changes throughout the ages, but it's exactly the same dynamic. Don't worry, guys, God sent you here to defeat the negativity and redeem the world and finally get rid of this terrible arrogance which has been holding us back from our salvation, keeping us from being redeemed. No, this is exactly what is keeping us from redeemed by making this claim that we need to triumph over something. That's exactly what is keeping us from acknowledging and realizing and acknowledging that all this is just a play of our own arrogance, and therefore we can set it all down this instant because we're not fixated. Whatever comes from us can never be fixated. Only believing this comes from something outside of reality could we possibly believe in fixation and believe anything needs to be done first in order to set down what is only in the instant in the first place. Our arrogance is only in the instant, instant by instant. It's never fixated. It's never fixated. That means we can let it go, all of it, 100% of it, this very instant. In fact, that's the only way to let go of it, is let go of 100% of it this instant. So there must be a way to do that, and there is. One insight settles it all, entirely. In fact, that's the only way to do it. One insight settles it all. And so we rehearse. One insight did indeed settle it all for me. One insight did indeed settle it all for me. When we talk about enlightenment, realization, these are just words. It's a better description is that all regrets are suddenly and gently smoothed out in your favor entirely. And there's not one single regret left whatsoever. Not even one. It's all smoothed out in your favor as you realize, oh, yes, indeed, there never was any separate arrogance from my own desire for arrogance whatsoever. Therefore, I can set it all down right now. And I was right that this one insight smooths it all out, and it's all settled in my favor. All my beliefs that it takes time have been shown it doesn't take any time at all. It takes no time at all to settle it all in my favor. Okay, it takes no time at all to settle it all in my favor. It takes no time at all to settle it all in my favor. Now, we're kind of austere here. I tend to be very austere. I don't go in for entertainments or anything like that. Which is great, because that's what we need right now. Because the entertainments the yoga girl's going to put on are going to be lavish and extraordinary to drum up your belief that you're called by God to vanquish the negativity, which is a total delusion, egoic delusion. God never calls us. God knows there's nothing to vanquish. How could we be called to vanquish anything? There's no fixation to vanquish at all. So it's ludicrous. The more you say, God called me to vanquish something, the more you're denying God. The more arrogant you're being. So there's going to be lavish entertainments. Now, we all are vulnerable to this, okay? This is true. Very vulnerable, actually. It depends how much work you've done in evaporating your continuity fear. But there's always a yoga girl that can get under your skin, okay? Either, you know, or maybe inspire you to be a yoga girl, right? You might be saying, no, I see, I hear what you're saying. Yeah, I'm salvation, redemption. One insight settles it all. That's what I accept. And then you might see the yoga girl and say, wow, you know, I kind of feel like maybe I could be like her. That seems so, you know, compelling. If you're a woman, you might say, that seems very compelling. not literally if you're a woman, of course, but if your identification is that way. So you might be tempted, like, to start, maybe I could do some inspiring, you know, like that. Maybe I could be in a Joan of Arc. So there's always one that's going to get under your skin. And if you're identifying as a male, there's always a yoga girl that you say, oh, she could be really inspiring to me, you know, that kind of thing. Always, always. So how to play the situation? I've thought about this, and you know, the entertainment and inspiration of the world toward positivity is likely to get very extreme coming up, very extreme. And in the 60s and 70s, there was a lot of this sort of stuff going on, okay? And people were attracted to the music and the concerts and the drugs and sex, drugs, rock and roll, all that stuff. So I tried to provide music for people that at least would give them some entertainment, but it would lead them away from the real dangerous stuff. And so it wasn't very successful, but at least I'm aware of this. Is it possible that some sort of entertainment could be given to those who are choosing one insight settles it all, which would at least make them feel they're not totally left out? Because you can get this feeling like you're literally being left behind. All this positivity is leaving. They'll tell you you're being left behind. If you don't get with it, you'll be left behind. I got hit with this by some spiritual, not real spiritual teachers, but those who claim that they're enlightened, etc. And they told me, if you don't stay up, join with us, etc., you're going to be left behind, and you know, this kind of stuff, the ego's going to get you, blah blah blah. I said, wow. So even in the all the new age spirituality, that's all, it's all positive based, actually. It really is. And they're going to tell you you're going to be left behind. We have this super positive, no, not super positive, we have this super abundant positivity future, super abundant positivity. We have this abundant positivity world coming, and you don't want to miss that. It's so great. And of course, that's actually the very root of arrogance and delusion. You'll actually be more arrogant than ever before. But you're going to feel like you're being left behind. This is a problem. It is. I understand this. So, you know, should you have some rock star that you can identify with to take the edge off, feel like I'm missing out on all the positivity, oh my gosh, I'm being left behind? And should you have some entertainment, you know, or should you just go completely austere? I don't know. This is a question that I still is not resolved for me. How exactly to play the chess pieces? I don't know. I can go either way, actually. It's more dangerous to go to the rock star route. It's safer to go the austere route. But is it safer, really, if you have nothing, you're not doing anything to help the world? In other words, this is my life. I've not done anything to help the world, but I've done a lot to help free us from the world. Okay. So it's been very difficult to feel like you're not helping, you know. I'm not giving to charities. I'm not doing social movement, part of social activism. I'm not championing this or that. And it just seems like I've done nothing to help the world. True enough. But I've done massive amount to help liberate us from this delusion of a world. However, it is very tough to feel like you're not doing anything to help the world, because basically all the yoga girls feel like you're a zero. They treat you like you're a zero. You haven't done anything to help us. Well, what do you mean? I haven't done anything to help you increase your arrogance? Well, that I must be doing something great if I'm not helping increase your arrogance. That must be really helpful, super helpful. So I've not been helpful. I've been super helpful. But from the world's point of view, I've not done anything. So this can certainly get to you. So there is a way, I see, but it's a, you know, I don't know, it's six of one, half a dozen of another. I don't know if I would be good in that role at all. I kind of doubt it. But you instead of being in service to fixing the world, you're in service to a guru or something like that, or a situation of devotion. And so you feel like you're helping do something. You're part of something. You know, you're part of some movement. Because if you're not part of anything, which is what my life's been like, it is very tough. Very, very difficult. So I let the Dharma Kings work it out. I don't know. It's a dangerous thing for anyone who's a figurehead of such a thing like that. It can get to go to their head, you know, and cause them problems. But I do see that there could possibly be some utility to that for help others in terms of they feel they're part of something, they feel they're working on something, they feel they're doing something to help in some way. There's some entertainment involved. That you know, they feel like they're following someone who's inspirational. All that stuff's involved, but it's really all focused on one insight settles it all and right spiritual practice. So you're also doing that. Whereas if you get into the positive folks, they never get around to real spiritual practice at all. They don't even know what it is. In fact, they're completely opposed to it. But you know, that's a tricky tightrope to walk on for anybody who tries to, you know, let the Dharma Kings work that out. I don't know how they're going to work that out, really. We could have a band like the Beach Boys, you know, sing some of that music. You know, it's very possible you could do that. Get a Hammond B3, Fender Bandmaster amp or twin reverb, you know, a nice old Stratocasters. and you know, that's pretty much what you need. Some sleigh bells, some tambourine, and bass and drums. And then work on the singing parts. And you could if the guys are musicians, you could easily put something on. I've been singing in case I have to do that, you know, in case I'd be part of a band like that that gives entertainment to spiritual devotees who are focused on one insight settles it all, true non-duality. They may need to glom on to something, you know, going it alone. I don't know. So 50-50, I'm not sure how it goes. If you try to go on your own right now, you can become very reclusive. That's possible, yeah. So we're just looking at this, right? We're just saying what's possible. Because all the rock stars and yoga girls, everybody's going to come out of the woodwork in terms of boosting positivity against the negativity. Everyone will say, oh, there's an overwhelming flood of negativity. We got to fight back against it. And if you don't, you'll be submerged. But actually, what is submerging us is our own arrogance. To believe that some arrogance is not our own arrogance. And we're hiding this fact from us through this dance of positivity, negativity, and especially through positivity. That's the root of it, the root delusion. So to go in that direction is merely to strengthen your delusion. So we will not be overwhelmed by negativity because what we're saying is one insight settles it all for us. All of it. Just like that, in one instant. In one instant, one insight in an instant settles it all for us, once and for all. And this is absolutely true. So we are going on with this faith. We have a faith. So do we need a religion? Do we need some movement, charismatic movement or something to help people out? I don't know. That can easily tip over into positivism, right? You get the yoga girls and yoga guys sabotaging it for sure. Which I see is they're certainly have no compunction, no hesitation to do that. It's amazing. On Facebook, I keep posting, you know, what I'm about, and they just ignore it and just keep posting their positivity. We're going to do this. I say, do you not see what I'm posting here, folks? Super positivity, not positive. No, they just ignore it. So they'll certainly just barge in and crash the party if they can. ouch. Yeah, the left wrist is causing me problems. Oh. Wow. Painful. I can't put any weight on that at all. Can I put any weight on this left wrist? Which you might say, I'm not putting any weight in the left, liberal left. I'm not investing any weight in them. No waiting for what the left's going to do. I can't put any weight on the left. I don't see any value in that. And the other doesn't see any value on the right. Well, Good. No value either one. So let's go and value in one insight. So one insight in an instant settles it all for us. And again, I am vouching for this. I am absolutely vouching for this. And will continue to vouch for it. I've vouched for it my entire life. I'm not likely to stop vouching for it now. Now, you know, I might be shaken by the palm tree in a hurricane. But, again, let's face it. The yoga girls, they know how to, you know, do their thing. And we're all somewhat vulnerable to that. I'm getting, people are telling me, you know, like their wives are getting hysterical and very difficult to, they're just dominating through hysteria right now and panic attacks, hysteria, super tantrums and stuff, where the men just like, okay, dear, you know, just what I'll do it. It doesn't matter to me that much. I'll do whatever you say. Just calm down. Will you calm down? Calm down. Okay, I'll make this decision, which is a bad decision, of course, towards positivity. And then they say, oh, thank you. Thank you. Really calm me down. So they're pitching these fits, which are all designed to get us to agree to positivity. So hell hath no greater instrument of its persuasion than a woman having a hysteria fit. Believe me. There's no man on the planet, unless it's a Dharma king, who are not really men or women, who can truly handle that. As a fact, I'm the same way. I understand. I absolutely understand. If you're a man, you say, "Well, I made these bad decisions." Well, yeah. If your wife is or your significant other, or whatever, is pitching a severe hysteria fit, and I think I'm having a heart attack, you know, and oh my God, you know, and it just, you know, you say, oh, what can I say? What can I agree? Okay, we'll go there. Don't worry, we'll go there. I'll take care of it. Don't worry. Oh, I feel a little better now. Thank you so much. You saved my life. You know, wow. Who is not vulnerable to that? And this is what's being utilized. It's always been utilized. In this dream of arrogance, there's this. We've imagined this dynamic of female hysteria, which trumps men's better judgment and reason. It certainly does, and has trumped it over and over and over throughout the history. And the same way, they're also able to go, like, you know, superabundant positivity, superabundant, the cheerleader, they go super cheerleaderish, like in Nazi Germany, the Fraulein's went super cheerleaderish. First they went all hysterical, we need someone, you know, leader, power leader, oh, there he is, super, then they switch into this manic phase. They go from hysteria, negative hysteria, to positive hysteria. You know, depressive hysteria to manic hysteria about, oh, he's here, the chill pom-poms out, and what are the men supposed to do, you know? Say, no, I'm not really sure. Why? They just get it from both sides. So it tends to override reason. And then the men say, okay, we got to go on with this positive regime here. Let's defeat negativity. And, you know, then you had World War II, you had wars throughout history. This is what happens. Exactly what happens. And so we're set up for that right now, big time. Really set up for it. And on the same hand, we're also quite resistant to it at this point in history. Okay, so I don't want to point too negative a picture. We're also quite resistant to it. And because it's going to be so severe this time, we might say, you know what, I just, not yet. Just like I said, I'm not going to Vegas yet. And I got the supervisor to grant me a reprieve. I'm sure the Dharma Kings did that for me. It was quite interesting. He said, no, you don't have to go to Vegas yet. Don't worry, okay? I'm sorry about your friend, and we understand. So, granted a reprieve. So, we do not have to go along with the yoga girls and the yoga guys at this point, the positivists. We can say, well, yeah, but a little bit later we'll go along with you, maybe. If we can swing it. I told the guy, I don't know if I can swing it, because I said, you don't know what's going to happen. You know, I'm not really sure. You know, life throws you some curveballs, you know. And they said, yeah, I understand. You know, so it's really tough to, you know, I can't really pin myself down. I was talking to them. They're trying to pin me down. I said, you know, stuff just happens out of nowhere. You know, it's just happening to me now, and it's just amazing. I don't know. So yeah, I want to go, but I can't, you know, promise you absolutely, because, you know, who knows? God only knows what's going to happen, right? And he said, yeah, I understand. So we don't have to en masse fall into this positivist trap. Again, the trap is a positivist trap set up by the negativists. The negativists are the foil for the heroines, okay? This is how it always works. Because without the negativists, how could the heroines really get under our skins like that? We'd say, no, there's no fights to fight, really. So there's no contrast. So they use the contrast to fool us, thinking there's some difference there. But really, it's all just arrogance, isn't it? It's all just arrogance. What if there's no fixation, what is it we need to defeat? Do we just not need to accept our freedom? And if we accept our freedom, how could there be anything that needs to be defeated? Positivism simply says there's this negative fixation, and we need to cure it by positive fixation. And what non-dual teaching says is there's no fixation at all, neither negative nor positive. And this is the correct teaching. Through my own experiencing, this is the correct teaching. This is what I'm going with. And it's the lifeboat, so to speak. But the kicker is, our lifeboat is a luxury cruise liner. I mean, it's like the most awesome boat you've ever seen. The greatest cruiser of all time. You know what I mean? Or, it's just like, wow, it's solid gold. Wow, I mean, it's just amazing. But we think of it as a lifeboat because, like, we're being rescued from the positivist Titanic that's about ready to sink. We're about ready to sink into this icy cold, dark, hideous ocean of positivist delusion. That positivist fixation is the answer, because it's triumphing over negative fixation. And again, the answer is to recognize there's never been any fixation at all. In fact, fixation is completely impossible. We're entirely free. Spirit is completely free. It can never be fixated. There's no way whatsoever. A dream of fixation is only happening in the now, this instant. And at any instant, we can choose a different experiencing. So we're not fixated, even though the dream is a dream of fixation. That entire dream is simply arising in the now. And we're not fixated. One moment is never fixated to any other moment. Just like a dream of time is just happening right now. When we're thinking of time, let's think of time, imagine time, like imagine 100 years, that's a long time. We might start to feel like, well, I'm feeling this long time period. But where and when are we having this feeling? Right here we're having the feeling, and right now we're having the feeling. And so that we can just shift off of that without manipulating any fixation whatsoever, and we realize, poof, it's gone. So do not try to manipulate any fixation whatsoever in the dream. Leave everything exactly as it is right now and shift your attention to clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. Leave everything in this dream of positive and negative battling fixations exactly as it stands this very instant, and shift our attention to clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. I have this balloon that keeps reflecting, welcome home, it says, and it's just moving in the breeze here, and it keeps reflecting light, and I keep thinking something's happening. I look at it, and oh, it says welcome home. It's a very useful little prop here, actually, and it's, oh yeah, welcome home, that's right. That's what we're headed towards, right? Welcome home. Welcome, so I'm home. One little insight settles it all, and I'm home. One little insight settles all regrets, and that is home, isn't it? I'm home. Realize, oh, I never left home. If I never left home, how could I ever have regrets of leaving home? See, all these regrets are regrets that we have. We think we left home. But then with one little insight, we realize I never left home at all. So what happens to my regrets? Poof, gone. It's all settled in our favor. Because every regret we have, its root is the belief that in some way, wow, we have left reality in some way, somehow. And we realize we haven't at all. That settles the regrets. So my wrist is still really bad. I thought I was getting better, but no. So don't put any weight in the left, which is what positivism. They want to spread positivism everywhere, but in order to do that first, they have to spread negativism everywhere, which is what they've been doing for the last, 8 years or more. But so the positivists, actually, it's funny. One hand, they're supporting positivism. The other hand, they're supporting negativism. They're fostering as much negativism as possible, so then they can come riding on Joan of Arc, come riding on a white steed, and saying, "I'm here to lead you to triumph over the negative fixations here." And don't try to do all the chess moves yourself. Forget about that. Just focus on one insight has indeed settled it all for me. And rehearse that in your feeling of one insight has indeed settled it all for me. It's been completely settled for me. I never left home. I was never fixated at all. Even the dream, this dream of fixation was never fixated at all. One insight has indeed settled it all for me. So leave everything exactly as it is right now. Don't work with any fixation one way or the other. Don't try to make it more negative. Don't try to make it more positive. Don't try to shuffle it. Don't try to blend it. Don't try to do anything with fixation. Just let it all be exactly as it is right now. And just shift your attention to clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. Shift your attention. And you'll realize that one insight has indeed settled it all for me. Wow. So, see, we're not caught empty-handed here with what is coming. Not at all. Not at all. The Holy Spirit said, "I will not leave you empty-handed. I will not leave you without comfort." So, we're not caught with our pants down as this troubles come. We're not empty-handed. We're not up a river without a paddle. No, we're sitting pretty. We're sitting real pretty. Now the chess pieces are flying around the board. That is for sure. But we just say, you just stay with our practice and trust in the fruit. It's like you have a fruit tree and all the fruit is ripening. You can see it. It's laden with fruit. And some of them are almost ripe, and you realize there's a huge bumper crop coming in. And you say, "Hey, I'm not going to abandon this tree. I'll just wait a little while. I know I'm going to have a bumper crop, so I'm not concerned about that." And right conditions come, the fruit ripens quickly, actually. And we have very ripe conditions right now in the world, because for us to ripen the fruit of realization. Ripen the fruit of realization. One insight did indeed settle it all for me in an instant. It was all settled. One insight in an instant did indeed settle it all for me in my favor. Completely in my favor. 100% in my favor. And there's not even a single bit of regret left in me whatsoever. Now you may, in your practicing or your sleeping or whatever, you may suddenly feel your body might suddenly give a little jolt like this, like you've just shifted somehow. I experienced this, quite a bit on and off. It just, where you let go of a fixation complex, as it were. It gives you kind of a jolt, a little jolt. And in some way, you know, whatever, everyone's experiencing is a little different. You get the shudder, so they sudden, you know, sort of massive shudder. Oh, you let go of this fear, like this terrible fear that you had, that you know, you're in big trouble. Now you realize you're not, and you sort of let go of that fear. I don't know how to fix this wrist, though. I need to use the wrist. Ah. But it will come. It will come. It's a warning sign of some sort. Don't utilize the left. I can't utilize the left now. Don't utilize the tricks of the left, which is positivism. And the same hand, they foster social chaos and division and all sorts of negative fixations in society through the wicked entertainment that they promote, through Hollywood entertainment industry, wicked, wicked negative fixation stuff. And then when everybody's in this horribly negative mood, then they trot out the liberal yoga girls and guys and say, here's the positivism we promised you. You know, this negativism is terrible, isn't it? We got the answer. But we say, hey, wait a minute, but you're the very ones that fostered the negativism in the first place, negative fixations. Say, no, it was those wicked other ones that did that. It's like, what? Really? I don't think so. They were saying all along, hey, you know, we don't want these negative fixations. That's going to polarize everything. So you don't want to polarize society, because then we fall right into the trap of positivism. We want the middle path, you know, where we don't really go into too much fixation either way. Now, that might seem kind of boring, less drama, less operatic, right? But it opens up the door, helps us realize that one insight, focus on one insight, instantly did indeed settle it all for me. You talk about a present. This is the present that's within you. That little insight is there within all of us, simply waiting for your willingness for it to arise. That's it. It's already there. It's very close to the surface, actually. It might already be on the surface. You're just not looking there. And all this, you know, mumbo-jumbo the yoga girls and guys may trot out a whole bunch of esoteric practices and blah, 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 blah. No, forget it. This practice here is the best practice. And that is rehearse. One insight did indeed settle it all for me. And rehearse believing that this has already happened for you. Not struggling with rehearsal. I don't struggle with it. I just kind of vaguely say, you know, I keep doing it. So it's little bit. And sometimes it's a little stronger than other times. But never try to force it. No, I never try to force it. But I know that I'll be doing it today and tomorrow and the next day and the next day. So I don't have to try and force it. I know that just if I just do it gradually like this, it will come. The fruit will ripen. It's like I can, you know, if the fruit ripens in a week, okay, I don't have to have it ripen today. So don't try to force it. Don't never try to force it. This causes backlash. It doesn't work. Just repeat it as often as possible. One insight has indeed settled it all for me, in an instant. One insight did indeed settle it all for me. One insight in an instant did indeed settle it all for me. Or just one insight did indeed settle it all for me. It's already completely settled for me. Completely settled. And one insight did indeed settle it all for me. This is all anyone needs to practice, actually. It's that. The whole spiritual path, from start to finish, all of it is simply encapsulated in this one simple practice. Nothing else needs to be done. Because one little insight does indeed settle it all for us. Permanently, smoothly, completely settled for us. All in our favor, entirely in our favor. And that's it. we realize we never left home. We never left the home of our freedom for fixation. It never happened. Never happened. So, how are you going to be knocked out today? This is the question. How am I going to be knocked out today? I know I've got to do some errands and stuff that look like, oh my gosh, I'm not really interested in that. But how am I going to be knocked out today? I don't know. But just pray for it. Vigorously pray for it. God, send your grace in any and every way. Move the chess pieces of your grace on the board, on my chessboard, to absolutely knock me out today. So I'm just like, wow. That's so helpful, I can't even put it into words. And really, 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 really say, wow. God has already knocked me out today in a tremendous way. Instead of pleading for it and hoping to get it, act as though you've already got it. I've just been absolutely knocked out today by the grace of God. And I'm so grateful for that, and I'm just wowing it. I'm not emotionalizing it. I'm not getting all blubbery. And I'm not trying to intellectualize it and get dissected and philosophize it. I'm just wowing it. Wow. God's grace did indeed just knock me out today. Score one for God and knock out. Problem is like for entertainment, is in order to hold the audience, you end up becoming more and more and more and more and more drifting towards positivism, just because people are used to the Hollywood entertainment and they start craving familiarity. So you used to have like a lot of religious entertainment, but if you look at it now, the religious entertainment has become more and more Hollywood. The women involved in entertainment are becoming look more and more and more like yoga girls, even the conservative Christians and stuff, you know, because the audience seems to expect that. They expect positivism more and more, so they look more and more positivist. And then you get pulled into that trap. It's a real dangerous thing. Because once you get an audience, you don't want to lose it. But the audience may start drifting away back towards positivism, and then you might try to adjust to hold them, and you yourself might be pulled into it. So it's a really very, very tricky sort of thing. Very dangerous for entertainers, actually. It's a very dangerous gig. Most of them go bad. It gets to them. But if you do something truly down home and in the right way, some people might like it, but then they start drifting away. Yeah, the razzle-dazzle of Hollywood starts, you know, like, well, that's what happens. Even the non-dual teachers, I found this. Is they've sort of dried up and disappeared. The ones that have been around, I can't find them anymore. It's like, and they just, you know, they just, it didn't happen for them. And what happened was a lot of yoga girls went to them and say, yeah, we're really interested. What the yoga girls were saying is, we're really interested in getting you to help us out with our positivity, because we know that's the answer. And we want to use your charisma and those who follow you. You can help us out by preaching the gospel of positivity to the world. And gradually they've probably been undermined, which is why I don't have any quote-unquote followers or any camp followers or nothing. At this point, you know, there's nothing. I'm just me. That's it. So I can keep speaking the truth. I'm not being undermined, really. So again, I warned. I said this is going to undermine, and now they seem to be pretty much vanished. It's astonishing. And I've seen this historically. I've seen my whole life. I've noticed this, that anyone who's trying to preach the gospel, there's a great attempt to sabotage them. And most of them do get sabotaged. Not all. There might be a few that make it. I certainly pray there are a few. That many, I hope, that we all make it. But, we'll see. We'll see what happens. But, you know, they're always pressured. Like, I have this really great charity. Could you help me out with this? And, I mean, the yoga girls are so adept in what they do. The positivists are so clever at what they do. You almost, like, just cannot even hang around them at all. Because they're going to get to you. One way or the other. They're going to become hysterical. They're going to blackmail you. They're going to, you know, get you into some charity work. They're going to help you support their favorite cause. They're going to pull, because their whole mind is directed towards positivity. That's what arrogance and continuity fear is pushing them towards that. So they may act in the beginning. They can put on an act of being really interested in your teaching. And you think, oh, I got someone who's really interested. But then slowly but surely, bit by bit, they start pulling you into positivism. They're recruiters. They're expert recruiters. And I found very few in this world who really understand, you know, one insight sells it all, who really understand this dynamic. But there are some. There are some. Absolutely, there are some here. Absolutely, there are. So again, how the chess pieces get moved, I don't know if it can help out or not. Any sort of entertainment or situation, you know, where a focal point, it may just be ending up sabotaging the whole thing. You know, the way people's attitudes are right now, they're truly enmeshed in such severe positivism. It's just seems almost incurable at this point, actually. In the short term, it seems very incurable, very much so. Short term. So, in the short term, we may just back off and be reclusive. That's a possibility. I tell you, if you go out there in Tibet, you can be pretty reclusive, although there's Chinese checkpoints everywhere. You better believe it. You try to travel on any road there, and checkpoint, police checkpoint after police checkpoint, everything is heavily, heavily monitored. As my friend told me, the Chinese won't allow Tibetan language and writing to be studied in school. They have to learn Chinese language, Chinese writing. So in other words, you know, just complete cultural takeover, demolition, genocide, cultural genocide. In the short term. Tibetans are used to practicing on the sly. That's one of the reasons for their secrecy, too, is that the power structure has changed so many times there that they're bound to be on the wrong side of things soon enough. You know, they may be on the right side now, and then a little later they're on the wrong side. So it behooves them to not have anyone know that there's some lama, you know. Like Jamyang Lodro, he slipped through the border guards and everything by just posing as just some lowly monk, you know, lowly. And he wasn't some master of masters, maybe the most accomplished master in all of Tibet, because his look and profile and everything is such that he just seemed like nobody. And so the Tibetans are very skilled at being poker players, and they can pass themselves off as no attainment whatsoever here. So when they get on the political structure shifts, power structure, nobody can point them out and say, well, yeah, he's the one that's been practicing Dzogchen or whatever, because nobody even knows he's been practicing it for 40 years. So they very much, and they've hidden themselves among householders, the Nyingma tradition, in order to survive. A lot of it is decentralized from monasteries and that kind of thing, and just householder things, married with children. That way it's much easier to disguise that you're not even a practitioner at all, or you have no success at all. I mean, I'm just an idiot, you know. And they may pose that way. They may pose as idiots occasionally. on purpose. So when the power structure shifts and they're on the wrong side of it, they don't draw suspicion to themselves, because what do the new rulers want? They want to get rid of all figureheads that might oppose them. And so what do they go? They go after the renowned monks, the universities, and they destroy the universities and everyone in it. But the householders, they may not even know about them. The householders have said, oh, look, I'm a yak herder, you know? So a lot of the enlightened ones have been just these stonemasons and yak herders and stuff like this, where they hide the fact that they're practicing. Very much so. Me, I just pick up trash, you know, so nobody suspects me at all. Although for YouTube is certainly it's a different story, but in terms of just socially and everything, just a lowly sudra, you know, just a nobody. Are you kidding? This person knows this stuff. Are you kidding? That's ridiculous. Not possible. So there's a lot of secrecy in Tibet due to the volatile nature of the politics there. They've always experienced that, you know, really. It's just always volatile there. And it's that way around the world. A lot of those who are really, really keen on practicing tend to be undercover, you know, under wraps. Don't make any announcements of what they're doing, because the positivists will sabotage it for sure. The whole positivist, negativist script will sabotage it and say, no, we don't want that, we don't want that. That's terrible, that doesn't work. We got to get free of the fixation. What are you talking about? There's no fixation. No, there's just negative fixation. We got to defeat it. What are you talking about? You're crazy. And you say, no, there's never been any fixation. What do you mean there's never been any fixation? You're saying this world's not real, the universe is not real? Yeah, that's what we're saying. What? You're crazy. Bodies aren't real, no. Bodies aren't real. Nothing. Nothing that appears fixated is real at all. It's a imaginary dream to try to excuse our arrogance and therefore claim that all of reality isn't real. Some of our arrogance isn't arrogance. It's not coming from us. So this universe is supposed to be evidence that some of reality is not real. And if some of reality is not real, none of it's real, since it's all one. It's like the reality is just all one. Well, if you think it's split in half, how can you say, well, yeah, this half of reality is real, but this other one isn't, where the very nature of reality is this oneness? It's absurd to say that. Completely absurd. So I can't really work out so much. I can do my legs, but not my arms, and because of my wrist. Maybe I'll work out today. I don't know. Got no plans. Maybe a rest. But I'm sure once I go out, I'll have to do a bunch of errands here and this and this and that, and there goes the afternoon. So I just want to get this in the morning time here, which I've been able to do. Very super positive video here. And hey, you know, we're doing great here. We're doing absolutely great. I'm not finding what I'm looking for on Facebook, though, either. I'm finding the positivists are swarming. It's a swarm of positivists, really. There's a few who seem to give lip service to there's a couple that you'd say are legitimate, and a few who give lip service to it, but they're also showing to be trending towards the positive thing. They may be just kind of recruiting. Again, a lot of times the recruitment is from guys who appear to be interested in a sober way, but they're really controlled by the yoga girls. And so they sort of soften you up, and you drop your guard, realize, oh, okay, this guy's, you know, not really too much of a threat, you know, doesn't get under my skin, seems to be interested, great. But then they say, oh, I got a friend you should meet. They're really interested in spiritual reality, truth. And then, boom, they introduce the yoga girl who's actually controlling the whole marketing scheme. all along. And since you've dropped your guard, then you're kind of like, oh, you know, wait a minute. And you get kind of confused. And I said, but if I say no to kick her out, then the guy's going to go too. I said, why'd you treat my friend that way? You know, and then you think, oh, I'm going to, you know. And so you get trapped by that. And this is what I've seen. This over and over and over and over and over again here in this world. But not all guys are that way, but a lot of them, spiritually, a lot are, actually, is they're controlled by a yoga guru. I've had many approaches in this way, where the guy seems, oh, really, well, I really love what you're saying, and I really, this is great, I mean, this is just, I'm so fired up, and blah, 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 and they're getting me all feeling like receptive and feeling like, hey, this can really, really start to move. And then oh, I have a friend, you should check this out. It's a yoga girl, and she's really moving it out there, you know. And then you see how she's so positive and be able to move it out there. And you think, well, maybe she could help move this out there. But what it is she's moving positivity out there, not super positivity. And then you get sort of tricked in this way. You get seduced in this way. It's very seductive. The world is extremely seductive. It works through seductiveness. And the yoga girls are the masters of seductiveness. They most certainly are. And they may have multiple guys' levels working for them. This guy is attached to this guy, and that guy's attached to this guy, and this guy's attached to that, and then finally this guy's attached to the queen bee, and ultimately you get introduced to the queen bee of positivity. The queen bee of positivity, which is really the devil. You know, it's the root of delusion. It's what's most dangerous. The queen bee of positivity is the most dangerous delusion there is. The most dangerous. Nothing else comes close to this. The queen bee of positivity is the most dangerous snake of all. Because she's the one that will crusade you into defeating negative fixation and feeling that you've triumphed over your troubles by having this positive fixation, when in fact you've just immersed yourself even more in arrogance and created even more continuity fear, even deeper delusion. So the queen bee of positivity is the most dangerous viper of all, and she's very clever and very seductive. And none of us really know how to handle her so well, actually. I've never been able to figure out exactly. It is just, you know, because most everybody here are enthralled by it. You know, nobody can stand up to the queen bee of positivity here, except the Dharma kings can. Even they tiptoe around it. They need, you know, they don't want to cause too much confrontation, but they certainly can't stand up to it, no doubt about it. Yeah, isn't the world, they say, isn't the world wonderful? We need to celebrate the treasures and the beauty and God's gift to us and all this stuff. And this negativity is really, really interfering. But, you know, we're going to really do it anyway. We're really going to, let's celebrate, you know, all the positive stuff. And I'll help you do that. And we, yeah, let's get, you know, let's be inspired. You'd be more inspired. This is the devil. This is the most dangerous viper of all. Queen bee of positivity. But we're saying is, here's one insight instantly settles it all for us. That's all that has to take place, and all that ever can take place, actually, in this dream, is the awakening from the dream. And one insight awakens us. One insight settles it all. One simple little insight. No complexity to the insight. One little simple insight solves it all. And that's all that we're focused on here. How we doing? Oh, we're cruising along. Yep. I hope you've been able to stay with this. It's even more intriguing than that video of circumnavigating Mount Kailash. That has more visual wow factor, but this has spiritual, profound wow factor. Is we're re-emphasizing over and over and over and over and over, so we get familiar with it, which is, that's the absolute key, is this, who can re-emphasize this over and over and over? This is what's helpful. Saying it just once is not that helpful. It actually is kind of like taste of honey is worse than none at all. Because then you start panicking and you go into positivism. Here, we nag and nag and nag. We go over and over and over this. Like we repeat over and over and over and over. One insight does indeed settle it all. Rehearse this. So we get familiar with it. And it's familiarity that gives us this wonderful buffer zone and able to settle into one rehearsing. One insight does indeed settle it all. When we can rehearse this and we feel comfortable rehearsing this, then we do have some protection against the queen bees of positivity. Not completely, because we're still vulnerable to it, but we're certainly going in the right direction. At some point we can get in the lifeboats. So imagine yourself, you're already in the lifeboat and you're already drifting away from the Titanic. Imagine that. That one lifeboat has indeed rescued me from the Titanic entirely. When we get in a lifeboat and we're away from the Titanic, have we not been rescued from the Titanic as far as it's sinking? Of course we have. So one lifeboat rescues us, in those terms. Now, of course, we need to be picked up from the lifeboat, but lo and behold, there's this big ship there that's ready to pick us up from the lifeboats, actually. But first we need to get in the lifeboat as the Titanic is about to sink into delusion, severe delusion, which is positivist is the way that we get hooked and fooled most severely. It's about to sink into this morass. We're in the lifeboats and we're not on the Titanic at all. So imagine that. I'm in a lifeboat, not on the Titanic. And imagine the Titanic sinking. And you're not panicking, you're just say, okay, one insight does indeed settle it all in my favor and everyone's favor. Rehearse this, wow. This massive ship, indestructible ship, the Titanic. I just saw the whole thing go under the ocean with everybody on board, almost everyone. Wow. Because this is what's going to happen in this world. Most everyone in this world is going to sink into the ocean of delusional fixation. One insight did indeed settle it all for me. One insight did indeed settle it all for me. Remember, the purpose of the Titanic was to sink. And the purpose of everybody on board, most everyone, was to make sure that we all went down with the ship. So that was that purpose from the very beginning. So it was a trick, it was a trap. So you escaped the trap. And the positives that we just want to keep our arrogance going. So we can keep pretending that we're greater than God. Keep this delusion and fixation going. This false belief. So they're intending to sink. Of course they will sink. That's their purpose. We don't have to be on the Titanic when it sinks. No, we don't. And of course, all the ego backlashes always will try to rise up and get us. We'll say, that's not right now, a backlash. Okay, later on we'll entertain, maybe we'll entertain that. Maybe later we'll go to Vegas. But not right now. I just say one insight settled it all for me in my favor entirely. Zero regrets. So how could there be any backlash at all for that? None. okay, I'm starting to get drowsy. This is, it's, you know, stressful time for sure. Got some sleep, but I'm still feeling drowsy. Papaya and let it ripen up. I purposely got one that was already really ripe because I knew I was going to use it right away for a smoothie. So, you know, the consistency can be real ripe. That's okay. And Odwalla, I don't know if you hear market has that, Odwalla, chocolate protein drink. It's very good. It's very smooth and good. I think Bolt House, I can't find it anymore. They used to have a really good one too. But Odwalla is still making theirs. Or if you had to, you could use chocolate milk, but that's got a lot of stuff in it. And then add protein powder to it. You know, chocolate protein powder. And blend that up, puree it, blend it up. Wow. Now when you let it sit in the fridge, it will coagulate. So what I did is I drank like 2/3 of it right off the bat, put the other third in the fridge. I know it'll coagulate, and then I'm gonna throw some tart red cherry juice in there. To then blend that back up so it's more, it's liquid again, and then I'll drink that. That'll be, you know, something later on in the day. My weight, it's starting to go back down a little bit. I saw a nice number this morning. I'm still like a pound and a half away from where I want to be, but I'm starting to go back in the right direction again, which is amazing. I thought I'd really blown it really badly because I had a very heavy dinner last night. We went to KFC. I got the coleslaw and the baked beans. Added that to some macaroni salad I'd gotten, some really good stuff. Put some lettuce and vegetables in there, and then some tortilla strips. Mixed that up. Ah, it was heavy. It was big, you know, big dish, but wow, was that good. Oh, man. Of course, I don't get the chicken at the Colonel because I'm vegetarian, but I get the coleslaw is really good. The KFC coleslaw is really good. There was a manager there that would wait on us, and they did like a really good job, like unusually good. We noticed, like, wow, this is really so weird. I mean, why is this manager so good? Usually, the place looks neat and clean, and everything's, they treated us in the right way. I said, wow. That reminds me of a manager that was there like about 10 years ago, 12 years ago, 12 to 10, you know, a couple years. It's our friend. This guy was the best manager you've ever seen. He made everybody that came in there shout out by name and treated them like they were VIPs. And he'd give us freebies all the time. I mean, he'd just say, hey, free cookies here on me. It's like, what? Who does that? And so you felt like you're visiting your friend. He was just like the maitre d', like a super great maitre d'. And the staff was trained. They were all that way. It was like going to KFC was like an event because you felt you were treated like you were somebody really valuable and important. Who would think at a KFC, right? You think you got to go some French restaurant or some expensive. Of course, they treat you like snobby, like, you know, you really belong here? I kind of doubt it, but maybe if you order the best wine, the most expensive meal, we might think you might belong here. This is a trick they do. They treat you like snobbishly, so you feel like I got to prove to them I belong, so you like order the most expensive stuff and all the, and surely you want this wine, right? And this, oh, yeah, of course I do. Yeah, well, absolutely. And they pile the bill up that way. This is a trick they use. So we were treated like royalty at this KFC. It's like, wow. And then, so this lady's treating us great, and I'm just like, so surprised. And so I say, somebody somehow asked, yeah, we used to come here. There used to be a really good manager here, I mentioned. There used to be this place, she said, a super manager, his name's so-and-so. And she goes, oh, yeah. I say, what do you mean? You know this guy? He goes, oh, yeah, I know him really well. He was my manager. I said, what are you talking about? He said, well, he moved over to this other place, which, you know, he moved to another KFC. And I said, he's still there after 10 years, 12 years? He goes, yeah. I said, oh my gosh, that's unbelievable. And he says, yeah, he trained.